I had vaguely leftist sympathies almost from my initial college days. Though I think in the beginning I was more of an admirer of Bertrand Russell. And through him I had an idea that communists are good in the heart but wrong in the head. That's roughly Bertrand Russell's attitude towards the communist movement. Up to the emergency, I also thought that I had a lot of friends among the Naxalite movement in Warangal where I was studying. But I thought that philosophy was all wrong. Though they were good in the heart, their heart was in the right place. The emergency, that way, I couldn't find anything in Russell's philosophy which would explain the emergency, or in anything else that I believed at that time which would explain the emergency. I thought the Marxist understanding would help me to explain more. If you remember right, it was during the emergency that I declared to myself that I am a Marxist hereafter. And later I became a sympathizer. But as far as the activity is concerned, I was only in the civil rights movement from the very beginning. 1978-79, I was in the civil rights movement. Because being in Warangal made a lot of difference. If I had been somewhere else, perhaps I wouldn't have been involved in this. Warangal was a major center for the ML movement in its earlier phase, where one could see its social content, but one did not have to infer it directly. One could see it physically, that they were there among the poorest sections of the people, and for whom the law had done nothing for the last, by that time, 30 years. Today it is 50 years, that one could see. And I think also that it is partly to the credit of the civil rights movement in Andhra Pradesh that we have been able to educate the ordinary people that encounter means murder. Today one does not have to tell them. It's taken for granted that encounter means murder, and today the position is that the police have to explain and prove that it's a real encounter. That's, I think it's some achievement that has been the achievement of the civil rights movement here. That also has happened. Well, that's how it began. And subsequently it had to grow. It had to grow by the very logic of its the cause it exposed. My own view, which may not be fully accepted by everybody, is that once you formulate a protest in terms of principle, you have to, firstly, you can never formulate a protest only in terms of interests. You can never say, I am being oppressed. You have to say, oppression is wrong. That's the only way you can formulate a protest. The moment you do that, the principle becomes universal. Not universal in the sense of 100% universal, but it finds for itself a class which goes beyond you. Then what happens is that you will have to speak for many more people, which again has its own further consequences. So a perpetual expansion of the principled concerns is unavoidable in the very fact that a protest has to be expressed in terms of universal values. So once we say that torture is wrong, it is impossible for the civil rights movement to say torture of Naxalites is wrong. You have to say torture is wrong. Once you say torture is wrong, you have to look at who else is being tortured. So we had to look. In the beginning, police used to make fun of us. That look, when you come to a police station asking for the release or to somebody to be produced in court who happens to be a radical, he's in the lockup. There are 10 more people in the lockup along with him. Why don't you talk about them? Police, of course, were not interested that we should talk about them. They were interested in exposing our one-sidedness. But we learnt a lesson from that. So we started saying that torture is wrong. Now, if torture is wrong, then you have to answer many more questions. Because you are saying torture not only of a political revolutionary, but also of a criminal is wrong. Then you have to answer for yourself, what is crime? What is civil rights movement's understanding of crime? Is it the same thing as that of the system, or do you have a different understanding? Can you be satisfied with a totally subversive understanding that can you say that all crime is protest? Obviously it is not. There is some crime which even ordinary people don't like, so one has to formulate a notion of crime. So the movement started expanding. 1985 brought about a major break. I remember very well that prior to 1985, I had a few Dalit students. I was then teaching in a university, who were of course friendly with us and appreciative of what we were doing. But pointedly they used to ask, sir, is it a human rights violation only if somebody is killed in a police lockup, but not if he is banished from the village saying you are untouchable? Is it not a human rights violation? I still remember answering that in that case, you are being banished by another citizen. It's between two citizens and you can approach the law. Whereas when the state itself oppresses someone, there is no recourse, practically no recourse in the law, and therefore we are not concerned about untouchability as a human rights issue. That was the answer we gave, I myself gave, until 1985. 1985, July 17th, there was a major incident in what is today Prakasham district, a village called Karamchedu, where a major assault on Dalits took place and six men were killed and three women were raped by upper caste people, who happened to be very closely related to the then Chief Minister N.T. Ramarao, his daughter's husband's village. It was that village. I'm saying all this because the civil rights movement, at least that wing of which I was a part and our friends have been a part, has always learnt from reality. I don't remember a single issue that we decided purely by theoretical discussion. We never did. We always learned from reality. And if you can say one thing about ourselves in a complementary sense, it is only that we were open to learning from reality. But that's all that we can say. Not that we could guess things beforehand and take theoretical positions before things came up. That never happened. I don't know whether any other stream of the civilized movement can claim such an achievement, but for us, being open to reality is the only thing that we can claim for ourselves. And we learned from this, and I remember very well, the other stream of the civil rights movement in our state spent a long time theoretically discussing whether the assault is a civil rights incident, violation, and should they go for fact-finding. We, on the other hand, didn't even bother to theoretically discuss. We went away the next day. We went to the village the next day, talked to people. When we held a press conference, we were forced to theorize. The moment you express values, you have to theorize. Another issue which came up within civil rights movement, which still is unresolved in the country as a whole, but in this matter we remain in a minority, this has come up everywhere, that is, do you have something to say to the revolutionaries, or do you merely talk about their rights in defense of their rights? You do defend their rights. You not only defend their rights in terms of law, you also take a quasi political stand that they are not to be treated merely as persons committing crimes or using violence. They are to be treated as a political movement. It's a fundamental point that we keep emphasizing again and again for society and for the state. An armed movement, let it be Alpha, let it be Hezbollah Mujahideen, let it be the People's War, let it be anything, LTT, irrespective of the fact that there are so many differences among them that we do distinguish if the need arises, still every one of them is a political movement. And the response of society and state has to be principally, primarily political, which is not to say that they are not committing offenses, which is not to say that the law shall not take note of their offenses and take legal action. It shall happen. Well, this is a point on which, of course, our friends have differed. They have said that we should never say that the law should take action against revolutionaries because a crime committed by them is an act of revolution. We said it's impossible for a human rights group to say that. It's a crime. It's an offense. What we do say is that look at the political aspect as the fundamental aspect and the aspect of crime as something which is attached to it, which is a consequence of the political nature of the act. Deal with the crime in terms of law, but let the law be something which respects rights. Let it not be any law. Let it not be an arbitrary law like the Disturbed Areas Act or the Armed Forces Special Powers Act, which gives the power to kill without kill on suspicion. It has to be a law which is democratic, which is respectful of rights, but law, handling them through the law should be only a minor aspect of it. Handling them politically shall be the major aspect of it. This, I think, is a complex of understanding that we have, and we want to communicate constantly to society and to the state. I was a teacher. I was a lecturer from 1981 to 85. A situation was created where my job was in Warangal, in the University at Warangal. To live and work at Warangal, I had to give up my civil rights work because the police were openly saying they would kill me. To do civil rights work, I had to leave Warangal and leave my job. I chose the latter. For about 13 years, I was a full-time activist. Then when I have a growing up son, and I also have to earn something. I can't put all the burden on my wife. So one reason why I chose to, and I thought of all possible professions. As a lawyer, I can continue my human rights activity both outside and inside the court, to some extent at least. I mean, one had very few, what one may call, illusions about the court. Not that one had no belief in the court, but illusions, additionally, illusions can be there. I did not have any illusions because though I was not a lawyer, I was a petitioner in many cases. I know the courts. But I chose this profession because it is closest to the human rights activity of all the possible professions. That's why I became a lawyer. After a while, we find that they may not say so, but it appears that we are the only persons whom they at least respect, in the sense that they feel they should at least explain themselves to us. I don't think they explain themselves even to their home minister or chief minister. So that also gives you a feeling that in the long run, my own understanding of the human rights movement is that it is essentially a moral concern. This is where many of my friends disagree. They believe it's a political concern. It all depends on how you define politics. But my only point is that essentially it's a question of you are establishing, asserting certain values other than the values of domination, power and oppression. And I do believe that here perhaps there's an element of truth in what Gandhi said, that ultimately the real victory is when you make the other person feel that what he or she has been doing is morally wrong, not when you behead that person and remove that person physically. So I think we have been able to communicate a strong message to the establishment, at least the police, that their exercise, their taking advantage of their power to behave in a lawless manner is wrong, morally wrong. We may not have stopped them physically from doing those things, but this is a message I think we have sufficiently been able to communicate. That's why they probably respect us more than they respect anybody else within the system. And we also find that a lot of people who are, whom we constantly criticize, constantly expose, have recognized the legitimacy of our critic to the extent that sometimes at least we are able to have some influence upon them, if not always, if not in a systematic manner. Whatever concern that people used to feel for poor people or oppressed people, it has been delegitimized totally. So people feel something. Feelings don't come only from your heart. What is socially legitimate is also an important input for one's responses and feelings. The delegitimation of welfare, concern, sympathy, that I think is the strongest negative factor with globalization. Other things are a question of policy. Policy-wise, one can very easily see how policies are withdrawing from welfare and increasing the poverty, alienation and so on. But my own view is that so long as we have a strong outlook in society, which believes in sympathy, in cooperation, in helping people, these things won't really work much evil, but that has been destroyed. And that delegitimation, globalization itself has taken advantage of the demise of the socialist experiment, the failure of the socialist experiment, which in turn has contributed to delegitimizing the socialist concerns. It ought not to have, because one way of trying to build socialism has been proved to be false. It doesn't mean socialism has been proved to be false, but that's how the message is taken by society. That is very bad. So today, for instance, we find it very difficult to get more activists, much more difficult than in the past. Wherever you have structured inequality, you have problems of rights. Wherever inequality is not merely accidental, but structured. It could be economic, it could be social, it could be cultural, it could be 100 things. But if there is structured inequality anywhere in society, it is a context for violation of rights. The very existence of inequality is a violation of rights, and it leads to further violation of rights because of the working out of the inequality. Mandal Commission came in 1991. We took a categorical stand in defense of the Mandal Commission. So caste was one. Gender was in the sense of dowry killing. I mean, like all parts of the country, Andhra Pradesh also has a major. So we started taking up those issues also. Once again, the man-woman relationship is an unequal relationship. Caste is an unequal relationship. A factory is a place where there is an unequal relationship. And with minorities being sidelined today, you also have, in religious terms also, unequal, communal terms, unequal relationships. So these things became issues. There was no serious objection to taking up these issues, but gradually a certain campaign was started that you are taking up all these issues either to intentionally to sideline the importance of the repression on the ML movement, or your unintended consequences that anyway. We overcame that by sheer hard work. We did so much work that we satisfied their requirement that we do a lot of work on that front, and also took up a lot of work on other fronts. Obviously, it couldn't last forever. That was one thing. And gradually, this discussion boiled down to one point, that is, agreeing, I mean, they also accepted that wherever there is structured inequality, there is a violation of rights, yes. But nevertheless, state repression should be central. We said, no, nothing will be absolutely central. What is central is a sporadic thing. Today, one thing may be central, tomorrow, another thing may be central. That depends on the context. There is no absolute centrality. That is one thing we insisted. The other thing which became quite a serious discussion was, see, when these movements, we support the right to agitate, we support the right to struggle, we support the right even to struggle beyond the limits of the constitution, because there is nothing absolute about the constitution. But when these movements start misbehaving, when they start behaving undemocratically, arbitrarily, do we or don't we speak out? This is a very major, and this touched them much more, because after 1985, when the Maoists, the then People's War, became more violent, incidents of amputation of legs and hands of informers, arbitrary actions, you go and want to kill somebody, you go there, you don't find him, you kill his brother and come away. Such things started happening. And especially given the importance of armed struggle, eliminating informers becomes very important. And what is the touchstone of your decision that somebody is an informer? They don't have any. It's a subjective decision of the local cadre. Sometimes the public also says, yes, he was a bad fellow. Sometimes they say it's a mistake, he wasn't an informer. There's no way of proving these things. So when these things came up, we took a stand that even as we defend the right to struggle, if movements behave undemocratically, it need not be only killing. Like in Kashmir, for instance, where they said women have to wear burqas, they can't come out without burqas. We said nonsense. We are fully defending Kashmir's right to secede from India. But you can't restrict the right of women to have equal treatment along with men. So such things, undemocratic behavior of any movement in its conduct, which includes also arbitrary violence, has to be condemned. That's the stand we took, which they disagreed. They still continue to disagree. ultimately they came around to saying this, that we should tell the party, tell the organization not give a public statement. We said there is no secret expression of human rights concern, it has to be public. That was the major. So the importance or centrality of state repression and the need to criticize the undemocratic acts of the movements, these were two very major. And understanding also, you see, they went on emphasizing rights is an issue linked to movements. We said there are lots of people who can't agitate, who can never become part of a movement. There are small communities which can never be a movement at all. They have to go to the law, they have to go to the court, they have to go and do something, get hold of some good people, good Samaritans to get something. That's also a concern for us. We can't keep quiet, we can't say we'll concentrate only on agitations, movements and repression on movements. So this was the way broad, and finally we had 1-2 years full thorough discussion within the organization. Identified 7 or 8 points of difference, had a debate, got thoroughly defeated and left the organization. That's how it was. About 35 of us came out of a total strength of 200 or so at that time. That's the thing. Concept of stock did not start with the Maoists or with the government. It started with a certain section of the intelligentsia, the Committee of Concerned Citizens. It began as essentially a concern that lives are being lost. The civil rights movement was concerned in a sense with one kind of lives. Not to the lives as such, but repression on people's movement leading to fake encounters and so on. The Committee of Concerned Citizens began at a different point. That look, whatever rights and wrongs apart, lives are being lost. And we would like to have a mode of development, mode of growth, mode of improvement, progress, where lives are not lost. Maybe if it is unavoidable that lives are lost, we'll come to that at the end. Let us not begin there. So that effort, and therefore it automatically led to a situation where they would address both sides. Why are you killing? Why are you killing? What is your answer? Then at some point it boiled down to this, announce a ceasefire and sit and talk. It was never very clear what they would talk. After all, I mean, it's if you have a movement like the Naga movement, there can be a discussion. We'll give you autonomy, not independence. You can't have half a revolution either. You have a revolution, you don't have a revolution. So what could be the talks? This is part of the joke behind it. But we said there can be talks not about